All right. Hey, Nikki, we're recording now. Questions. So let's start off with, why would I refer to you as the intro leading up to this video as a certified badass?
I don't know. You know, I was wondering, we might have some different opinions on that. I think you refer to me as a certified badass because I care. I'm very passionate about what I do. If I'm not passionate, I'm probably not going to do it, or I'm not going to do it for long. Also, I think I'm a good team player, which you are too. And I think you respect that we are similar. We're very different people in a lot of ways, but we work well together because we are both invested in what we do. And we are not satisfied with status quo or with good enough. I would say we both have that idea of a relentless pursuit of not perfection, but almost perfection. At least improvement, for sure.
Oh, yeah. We'll definitely won't take good enough. Absolutely.
Yeah.
It's funny. So, yes, and... one of the reasons why I think you're badass, I think two kind of examples come to mind. I won't kind of share the exact examples, but one is more, it's not only that you hold yourself to a high standard, but anything to do with candidates, you hold others to a high standard too, and you won't apologize for it. And you'll say whatever you need to them, to whomever is listening. And I respect that. You're never out to criticize. You never say anything that you wouldn't be okay being said to you. And you are the same person, regardless who is in the room, who is listening. And in this day and age of, we work with thousands of people, that is a badass, my friend. That is a badass. The other reason is because your life and your career parallel that as well, right? Mm. So there's traditional paths, and a lot of our candidates that we see, a lot of the students that I see at Dell, there is a very, prescribed path. And I'm, after the merger, even before the merger, but after the merger, I see so many paths now. And I think that it's so important that people, with focused intensity, if they see something, they work towards it. And they don't let other people's opinions discount their own work, their own thoughts. And when I hear, there's so many jobs in this, and there's so many jobs in that, I'm like, how many do you want? And
yeah.
they're like, I want one. And I was like, cool. Plus, I just read a stat the other day that the half-life of much of the knowledge that is up there is 5 years.
So, wow.
Yeah, so like, if we are working towards something for the next 5 or 10 years, with the current skill set and the current information, it's kind of like, well, could you imagine kind of mortgaging your passion and your life for something that may very much likely not exist in 5 years? So like, you're a badass because you go for what you want now, and you don't apologize for it, and you deliver. Nikki, always, you're the post person. You deliver. So for so many reasons, and then some, you are a badass. And I just want
thank to you.
Yeah, that a working professional CPA can be a badass. And we'll get into a bit of your personal and your professional in just a bit, but this is part of my weekly debrief. So Nikki, every week, students, they have a bunch of work to do. They have pre-work. They have videos that they have to watch that have an MCQ or few for each one. They have a CPA way question, so a financial reporting question that they must address in the CPA way. They spent the first week watching our videos, like watching our YouTube videos from the CPA way question. Then they have a debrief. So they have to say something that they did well in the CPA way question, something that they could improve on, and then give me a video question. So I compile their video questions into these FAQs, and I wanted to bring one of the FAQs to you right now.
Okay.
Okay, so we had this one on convertible debt. The CPA way question was on convertible debt, and right up until this point, they had learned about liabilities. They had learned about long-term liabilities, and then the very last chapter prior to the term test, they learned a lot about equity. And when we learned about equity, we called preferred shares and common shares, shares.
Yep.
Then we had the term test, and now we're in complex financial instruments. So we got the, it's complex. Sometimes we smush things together, and the CPA way question ended up having the answer where it was called preferred shares, but it had so many characteristics that substance over form, it was debt. Mm-hmm. And some people saw it because of the pre-work and the videos. And then other people were like, yeah, okay, I get it. And I get substance over form. But like they had in their mind, debt, bad, mm-hmm. equity, good. So wouldn't a company always want to make it equity? So I don't know about you, Nikki, but what do you hear when you hear the term always in accounting?
Oh, I think there's no always, or very rarely is there an always. It's always dependent on who your user and what your situation. So a fair warning, Sam did give me a heads up about this question. So I've had a few minutes to think about it, but not much, which is fine. But I am going to talk about with my family's business. So I grew up in a small business and my family decided because it's a funeral home. And so even though myself and I have two brothers, another one, which is a CPA, we had no interest in becoming funeral directors. So my dad and my mom and dad wanted to sell the shares, but they wanted, because they're from a small community, they wanted to make sure the community was well served when they stopped after 40 years of owning the funeral home. So how did they do this? They decided they had two amazing employees and they decided that they would sell to the employees. And so how they did that is through a share structure. So whereby my parents had the preferred shares and then these two employees were able to purchase the common shares. So in this case, the shares were structured for estate planning as well. So we know that is in this particular case, it's classified as a liability. And I was also talking with my husband, who is a banker, because I said to him, like, what happens when you see inevitably preferred shares that are classified as a liability? Just wanting to know, you know, what sort of that other mm-hmm. take, thinking about a whole host of users here. So first of all, let's come back from the perspective of my family. They didn't need any outside financing. So for them, frankly, they didn't care. Is it classified as an equity? Is it classified as a liability? They said, you just do what we have to do. It didn't matter. So then that made me think, okay, what is the perspective for a company, you know, when it is classified as a liability? How does that impact from a banking perspective? Mm-hmm. So I asked my husband and he said often what they will do is they will just get a postponement of debt. And so that is just an agreement where the shareholder says, you know, we're not going to redeem these shares for this particular period of time so that the impact on the leverage, the debt to equity covenant is not something that is so significant.
Nice. Nice. And that actually ties in really well. Thank you for giving that holistic perspective. No, it's fantastic because students have often asked, well, can they do that? Or what about this as far as how any agreement is written? And it's like, yeah, this is a legal contract. People get clever. Like, how do you think derivatives kind of came to be? Is people got really, really clever of how they wanted to make things sound. And we as accountants are like, hey, how are we going to capture this and reflect the economic reality of the situation on these financial statements? So I love that deferment, that postponement of debt so that you get that alleviation from the debt to equity ratio. That's fabulous. The other reason, so there's all these like pro-con lists. I kind of think back to like our CPASB, like debt is not always good in the sense that, or pardon me, equity is not always good because it can be seen as diluting, you know?
Absolutely.
And then debt is cheap. Debt is tax deductible. Tax doesn't call you at night and ask how its shares are doing. Debt wants to get paid back. It doesn't want growth. It wants you to do like good enough to like pay them the interest and then give them their money back. So I don't know, little pros and cons. Never say never and never say always.
Never say always. Absolutely. Yes. And it depends on who your user is, right? Like, that's a fundamental pep kind of, I would not methodology, but a way of thinking is approaching. You can't lump every user into the same bucket, because looking at a bank versus looking at my parents, looking at a public company, like, those are all different users. They all have a different take on the financial statements and those impacts. So it's really coming down to, like, how do you view this debt versus equity?
Yeah. And that's another reason we had this one prof, and we were switching off classrooms. And as he was coming in, he was like, accounting, you know, how do your students feel about, like, their, you know, accounting or like accounting being obliterated in like the next few years? And I won't say what he was teaching, but I was like, we good. We good, because we are teaching dynamic thinking. We are teaching people how to think about thinking and, you know, the substance of reform, and looking, scanning the environment and really looking at the users. Like, it depends. It depends. It depends. It depends. And I don't know, there's a whole lot of steps that AI has to get right before I'm even worried about it being able to provide sufficient software for certain things, let alone replacing thinking, breathing, you know, human to help advise you. So, perfect example. Thank you so much for that. Okay, so I wanted to get into a question, because you always have the most interesting perspectives, but now I wouldn't mind, could we get, and I'm very cognizant that I actually wrote Nikki into this for 10 minutes before we're about to do a training session, so we have a few minutes left. Can you provide me your bio? Like, who are you personally, professionally?
I'll give you a quick rundown. Okay, so I was never going to be an accountant, because accountants are boring. And they like numbers, and they like, okay, this is what I thought, and they love detail and accuracy, and this is like so not me. This is just not, that is not me. So I fought, and I have had like a path like this, very not traditional. I thought I was going to be a nurse. And so I was all registered. I was going to be a nurse. And then 2 weeks before I was supposed to start, right out of high school, I was like, nope, I'm going to go travel the world. So I went to Australia. I was a nanny. And I was like, taking care of people sucks. I don't want to be a nurse. It was great. Also made me realize I don't want to have kids for like a really long time. So I didn't. I didn't have my first kid till I was 33. It was great, though, that I kind of have had that path. So I came back, and then I went into finance, and I thought corporate finance is just, I thought it was very interesting. I started, and then I moved to Edmonton, and I started working for General Motors in corporate finance. And I realized really, really quickly that there just wasn't a whole lot of opportunity. I felt at that point in time, in essence, I was working for some old men who were just like, hey, Nikki, get, you know, you can do this. They realized very quickly that I could grasp things and I could do their work. And I thought, this is BS. Like, I'm never going to get to your level in that company at that time. And I knew that I needed, I don't want to say a shortcut, but I needed a way to propel myself from where I was to somewhere that I wanted to be. Because good enough, as you know, is just not going to cut it. So I finally relented. My dad for years had been like, you should get your accounting designation. And my little brother was just in university, and he had known he was going to be an accountant since the time he was like, I don't know, 8. So we ended up going through our program together, believe it or not. And I fought it. Like, I did not want to be an accountant. I actually went back to school. I thought I wanted to be a doctor. And I've told this to Sam before. I went back for a year and I killed it. Yeah. But I also realized I didn't want to be a doctor. So I just had to prove it to myself, like, I could do it. And then I was like, yeah, I'm good. So it took me a hell of a long time to get there. I had traveled the world in between. Like, I've taken a really long path to getting there. No regrets. I'm so happy that I did get my designation. And now when in the workshops, I sometimes hear candidates say, to be a good accountant, you have to be a C in the DISC profile. Don't worry about that too much. It just means somebody that values accuracy. basically, you have to be a certain personality to be an accountant. And I just say, that is so not true. If you want to sit there with spreadsheets and not deal with people, which is my little brother, he is an investment banker, he's a partner, he loves it. He always says, I don't like people. We love stocks and spreadsheets. If that is you, guess what? There's a place in accounting. If you are somebody who wants to talk to clients, or wants to work in education, or wants to work in so many other areas, there are so many cool paths. That was kind of the quick version of how I got there.
Before we launch into your like, what do you do now? And you said first kid. How many kids do you got?
I have two, boy and a girl. Kids. Yep.
And where's your home office? Where are you sitting right now?
I'm in my home office. I am in my basement. Yep. And I have, it has been
pre-COVID?
Pre-COVID, 12 years. 12 years. Yep.
Yeah.
The best thing about my home office is sometimes, not now, not this year, but every November for a couple of weeks, it is at my parents' place in Palm Springs. And I have a really nice table where I sit outside in front of the pool. And my home office has also been on a beach in Antigua. It was literally on buses, trains, in the back of Ubers, and on a beach for 3 weeks in Australia this Christmas. I've worked all over the place. Sam has too. I love my home office, wherever it may be.
I love it. That kind of drags us into our last question, one of our last questions, because I know we're getting close. Nikki, if I had to make you define success, right here, right now, what's your definition?
Oh, that's a really hard one. But I think it would be doing what you want to do in life, which, I mean, I'm doing that. And honestly, we all have to work so many hours. Work takes up a huge portion of your life. You have to do something that you love to do. There's no point spending your life hating doing something. And that is what I want to do. I mean, for me, my goal is to travel the world with my kids. I literally just yesterday booked a trip to Indonesia. I don't know when we're going. It's sometime after COVID.
but
the point is, I have a plan, and like, we're going at some point. That is my definition of success. Doing, like, crafting your life in the way that you envision and doing the things that you want to do.
Yeah. So many times I hear my students every year, and they have these big plans for their summer, right after they graduate, right before they start work. And they say these words, well, it's the last time I'll ever be able to travel for that long. And I just think in my head, and lots of times I say it out loud, I was like, bullshit. Or I challenge them. I'm like, why would you do that to yourself? Well, I have a student, or a former student right now, and one of the best compliments I've received lately was, he has a job in Toronto, and then he asked to work remotely because he wanted to go to BC, and because his family's out there, like, he had like some kind of free housing for 6 months to go live in like a millionaire's mansion or something. And right before he drove out, he said, like, this, I wouldn't have thought this was possible without you. Cause I was like, oh, like, awesome. Like, hashtag lifestyle design. He's like, I wouldn't have thought it was possible if it wasn't like without you and without the stories that you tell about like your friends and your colleagues. And I'm like, yeah, like, get out there and own it. So that leads us into my last question. Any parting advice you have for these wonderful human beings, these resilient, thoughtful, intense, but awesome humans?
Get your designation, get your CPA. Don't say you're going to go and get it in 5 years, because it'll just be so hard to get back. Do it. It's going to take work. It's going to take effort, but get your designation, because once you have it, it will open up so many doors. Even if you don't think that you're going to be a traditional accountant. I am not a traditional accountant by any stretch.
My younger brother,
right? Like, he is an investment banker. I know so many other people that are doing some really super cool things. And I think that this is going to crack wide open. There are so many opportunities. Like, Mark Carney, who was the governor for the Bank of England, and who was formerly Canada's, why am I just losing this right now? You know what I mean. Right? Like, he has said that the opportunities that there are for accountants that are working in climate change, and like we're going to see the impact of sustainability, climate change that is coming into our balance sheets. That's going to be the huge next wave. I personally have an interest in that, so I think it's really cool. Data analytics. I just think restructuring. Like there's so many different paths.
And if it isn't the CPA necessarily, but it's, you know, a master's or it's something to do with data or it's something that they feel like strongly in their heart. Yeah. Don't wait. Don't wait for permission. Don't wait for somebody to say, if you do X and Y, you will get Z. I know for myself personally, I have made the biggest leaps and bounds when people are like, are you effing stupid? And I'm like, well, I don't think so. I made all these things. And I just know that I have a personal board of directors. Nikki is is on it. She's leading the charge. You surround yourself with people that inspire you, that make you want to be better. And so thank you, Nikki. You inspire me.
You too. You same back. Like, it, no doubt about it. Sam does things that I told her, you have to do something once a year that makes you want to poop your pants. And she, I love that she took my advice. She gave me advice when I had my AI crisis. It's a long story. But basically what I did is I ended up investing, you guys, in so many Amazon stocks with some money I had set aside. And let me just say, that advice has paid off, literally.
Can't beat them, join them. All righty, exactly. We're going to head into a training session. Yep. Thank you.
You.